There has been a lot of really interesting discussions that has taken place throughout the week, very diverse types of interventions, types of people who spoke. We are very proud of the diversity we were able to ensure this year particularly. I mean, we strive for that every year, but I think this year tops all the other annual meetings we have seen in the sense of the diversity. We also have had children participating in five of our different of our sessions, of the 37, I believe, sessions, which has been really welcomed by a lot of you guys, and they brought a fresh perspective, they brought really interesting perspective, and gave us homework to do. So we are all happy for that, and willing to take up the challenge that they put in front of us, and we will hopefully not disappoint them. So if you can go to the next slide. So what I'm going to do is very quickly, I'm going to run through some of the, as a summary in a way, some of the drawings that our colleagues from journalism have prepared for us throughout the week from different sessions. I'm going to do this really quickly because there's quite a number of them that I was selecting. There's probably 50 something drawings, if I'm not mistaken, but I've selected about half of them. And unfortunately, this doesn't include a lot from today because I prepared this earlier, so I couldn't include everything from today. But what is interesting is if you, Julie, if you can go to the next slide, or if you give me control, I can also keep clicking, is that this element that you see at the center with the arrows going, the centrality of children and their protection kept coming back. And it is the theme of the annual meeting. So it's no surprise, but it's also very interesting that it's really becoming a language that we use, which I would like to hope that it will have an impact in the way we operate, in the way we think. So if you can go to the next slide. Perfect. I can move myself. As I go through, you will see that here on the left side, you have the socio-ecological model. This idea of children being at the center just keeps popping back up. We talked about, we had a whole session on centrality of children and the protection itself, which generated a lot of really interesting discussions. We did a recap on the first day of the Oslo conference, which again, in which centrality of children and their protection was really present. We ended the first day with a celebration of the International Day for Child or World Day Against Child Labor, rather, which also had participation of children themselves. So Ruba was a girl who spoke really eloquently, and her bravery and honesty and very clear messages to us was really appreciated. Also for the ones that were there earlier in the day, that day. We had youth activists. So this, as we went to the second day, we had youth activists share some very clear suggestions with us. They really called us to task and asked us to make sure that children are priorities in everything that we do. And one of them, if you can see on the right side at the bottom, they say, but you are actually working for us. So we have to make sure we know who the boss actually is. And children keep reminding us of that. The problem is that if you don't talk to them, they don't have an opportunity to remind us of that. Again, hot off the press was where some of our working groups and task force were able to share some of the newer developments in terms of products, training packages, and e-courses, and other things that working groups and task force have been doing in the past year or so. Child participation and accountability came up multiple times in many of the different sessions, but again, it speaks back to the issue of centrality of children across humanitarian action, in making sure that we actually talk to children and we feel accountable to children, that it's not that it's not just the job of the child protection sector to be accountable to children. Every humanitarian sector and operator needs to be accountable to children and speak to them. We talked about operationalizing the centrality of children and their protection, again, with some children reminding us of how that can be done. We talked, prevention came out, was featured strongly in multiple sessions. This, I really like this particular graphic in the middle where we're talking about not stopping, but rather we need to go beyond taking people out of the stream, but also look at why people are falling into the stream. So that theme came up multiple times in the different sessions. There was very specific focus on working across sectors for prevention. Children on the move, again, the issue of invisibility of children and the fact that children, if we don't make children central in the way we think, then we're not going to make them visible. So the invisibility of children was discussed strongly there. Again, other sessions on accountability to children and their participation. So just wrapping up my part before I hand over, I just wanted to mention that we have had 37 sessions across the 4 days. We have had 87 submissions, out of which 36 were selected to present. So within these 37 sessions, we have had 36 distinct presentations that were done. We have had 176 facilitators and speakers. We had almost 3,000 people register to attend, and over 40% of them actually joined. So we have had 1,243 people join. And when we did a very quick analysis earlier today, we have had 935 people who joined individuals, at least one individual session. And on average, each person has attended three. So there are people who attended 12 or 14, and there are people who attended one, but on average, it's three. So with that, I would like to pass the baton to Elspeth.
Yes, thank you so much, Hani. So I would just like to take a moment to reflect on the theme of our annual meeting this year. So if you go to the next slide, just to recap that the theme this year was children and their protection at the center of humanitarian.
Elspeth, you're a little bit quiet.
Action.
Ooh, there we really? Are, that's better.
Yeah, okay, maybe it's my headphones. Let
it's
me know.
It's gone funny again. Still...
No, it's fine. It's fine from our end.
I think it's the channel. If you're in the English channel, she got a little funny. So just add the English channel onto the floor.
Is this clearer now?
You're fine. I think it's the system.
Oh, okay. Okay, I'll keep going. So just to recap on the theme. The theme of the centrality of children and their protection at the center was actually selected based upon a survey with more than 200 respondents. And then within this, we had a zoom on accountability to children. So in line with the first strategic priority of our strategy, prevention in line with our fourth strategic priority, and also learning and development, which, as you know, has an elevated status during this strategic period. So moving to the next slide, I just wanted to take a couple of moments with thanks to some of my colleagues across the working groups to flag a few highlights from across this week. So I think we had a really inspiring opening session, and some incredible work has gone into documenting the evolution of the CPHA sector. It was really a celebration of achievements to date, and we really had the opportunity to reflect on the growth and the professionalization of the sector, thanks to bold and fearless practitioners before us, and really laid out some of the challenges and opportunities for our next chapter. So the panel with Cornelius Williams, Bill Forbes, and Alison Sutton highlighted the importance of true localization, this big shift to a systems approach, and how we still have a way to go to convince humanitarian leadership and our own organizational management to prioritize child protection. Actually, there was a session on competency-based learning. We heard a quote shared from emergency response partners along the lines of, we have been working with humanitarian response for a long time. We don't need training on this. We just need training on working with children parts. So I think this really highlights the journey we have ahead to ensure that working in humanitarian response is symbiotic with working with a child lens and with children at the center. As Hani mentioned previously, the Oslo reflection touched upon how the conference was a rare opportunity to focus on the protection of children in conflict and the central importance of their protection needs. It mentioned a new analysis of standalone child protection funding reported to the financial tracking system, which is highlighting the need for greater political and financial prioritization of child protection. We heard a strong call to action to step up our efforts around accountability. We have explored in several sessions and heard, including directly from children, what it really takes for us to meaningfully engage children and communities throughout the program cycle. And we've heard across the different sessions that current mechanisms and funding cycles often inhibit us from doing so meaningfully. We heard from Coalico in Colombia the incredible efforts made to bring children and youth to the table during the peace process over years and years of engagement. So there are great practices. We have a long way to go. And I think Bill Forbes highlighted in the opening segment of our meeting that the part of our next CPH journey is the growth of non-formal actors, including children themselves as essential change makers, collaborators, and advocates. The session on the International Day Against Child Labour had speakers, including Ruba, who drew very clear lines in their examples of the cross-cutting nature of child protection risks that drive and exacerbate exposure to harmful labour, including, for example, economic pressures and lack of access to education. And a session this morning with UNHCR emphasized this further and flagged the importance of child protection mainstreaming in other sectors as key approaches to prevent the prevention of child protection harms. So positively, it's clear there's a large and growing body of practical tools, initiatives, and best practices to operationalize the centrality of children and their protection across programming, across operations, across advocacy. We've seen excellent examples shared across the course of the week. We've seen Save the Children rolling out their own centrality of protection policy. We've seen the steps the Child Protection Minimum Standards Working Group are taking to support the implementation of Pillar 4 of the Child Protection Minimum Standards. The Learning and Development Working Group have been revising the CPHA competency framework to include competencies for working across sectors, amongst many more. We now need to really commit to effectively disseminating and promoting these tools, these resources, these best practices and initiatives. We've heard now in a session on food security and child protection. This also requires advocacy and resources to do so. It also requires that enhanced ability in the development of specific skills of child protection actors to better communicate child protection risks and interventions to other sectors in clear and concrete and non-technical context-specific ways. So moving forward, we're really excited to deepen our partnerships with sectors like health, camp coordination and camp management, and food security, using the success of our INEE collaboration and broader partnership with the education sector as a model. That's really what we're striving for. And with this, we would like to say a huge thanks to all of the wide range of actors, including from other sectors, for their support and active engagement across the various sessions of the meeting. I think this is a true testament to increasing appetite and maturity in our collaboration. So I think I'll stop there because we'd actually really like to hear from you. So these are just a few reflections, but now we'd like to do a quick Mentimeter. And we would like to ask you, after this meeting, would you feel more confident explaining the concept of the centrality of children and their protection after this meeting? So we'd just like to a quick yes, no, or do not know. So if you could just take a moment to answer this Menti. And it's totally okay if it's no, there's a long way to go still in really getting to grips with this concept and putting it into practice. We're seeing some promising feedback, so keep your answers coming. So far it's all yes, don't know. Brilliant. We just pause a few more seconds. Okay, so we have 21 yes, no no's at the moment, and one don't know. So that's definitely very promising, and lots of yes in the chat stream as well. So please, can we move to the next question? This is an open-ended question. So I think we'd really like to know what actions you will take as the result of discussions we are having on the centrality of protection. So these can be actions that you might take as an individual, that you might take as an organization, but we'd really like to hear sort of in your corner of the world or in your part of or in your part of your organization, what action you could take. Make friends in other sectors. Okay, I think I know which session this comes from. Fantastic, that was a clear call to action. Advocate more, advocacy really coming up. Involving mobilizing and implementing activities, I guess, with and for refugee children. Explain the concept with my colleagues in other sectors. Great, fantastic. Engaging with leadership, absolutely. Thank you so much. So please do keep the Mentee open. So please keep adding to this. I think it's really great for us to be able to capture this feedback and to try to support each other as we move forward on our centrality journey. So thank you so much. And with that, I'll hand over to the next main colleague, I think Camilla. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Elspeth. That's fantastic. It's really great to see the journey of this week's meeting. If we could just take the slides down for a second. The journey of this year's meeting through the visuals and also through some of the content from the sessions, and then finally hearing from you a little bit more about what your takeaways are in terms of understanding of the key concept and then how you're going to take it away. We also wanted to hear some key reflections on this and other matters from some colleagues who've been engaged in this year's meeting in different ways. So we're going to have a little reflection panel now. I would like to bring onto the screen our panelists. We have Brian King, I believe, is in the room, who is a journalist and child rights activist. And he was a very active, energetic facilitator of one of our sessions yesterday. So if we can bring Brian up into the spotlight as well. We also have Stephen Oladepo, who's the Executive Director of Rise to Inspire Africa Initiative and is the host of our Nigeria Participation Hub. Hussein Abdullah Salman, Deputy Board Director and Grants Manager of Brent Al Rafadayan Organization, or BROB, in Iraq, host of the Iraq Hub. We then have Elsa Laurent, Protection and Gender Technical Expert of DG ECHO, and Brukena Zogaj, External Engagement Senior Advisor for Child Protection at World Vision International, and also member of the Alliance's Steering Committee. So I have three of the panelists up with me now, and hopefully the others will join shortly. Do we have Stephen and Brian in the room?
We don't, Camilla. I'm sorry, Brian. Okay. Brian got locked in the networking. And,
okay.
I've not all seen right. Stephen, but as soon as I see them, I'll add them to the panel. No worries.
Okay, we'll ad lib, no problem. All right, so we have a first question that I'll send to Elsa, and then we can pass on to the others if they join us, and maybe Kana might have some reflections on it as well. So if you bring up the slide, just so people can see the question. So we have, what do we need to do to get other humanitarian actors to incorporate the centrality of children and their protection into their work? So obviously we've heard quite a lot earlier on in this session, but we'd love to hear your reflections, Elsa, if you're willing.
Sure. Yes, as you said, there has been a lot of thought and reflection and very rich and inspiring, actually. At the same time, it's really the unending question. I think we have had many discussions also with you, Hani, and a number of colleagues around the room on how to promote, to incorporate centrality of protection. I don't want to already repeat all the great ideas and input that have been put forward, but maybe one thing from my end would be first, of course, to continue to I don't know if I can say aggressively promote and advocate for the centrality of protection for children with the humanitarian leadership, for instance, is something that that has been done a lot. But really trying also for me to see how donors we can actually contribute and bring that also to the, you know, in the plate of the humanitarian leadership to take it very seriously and basically give a bit more accountability vis-a-vis also the other sectors. So one entry point is it continue to be the humanitarian leadership. The other entry point would be, and I think we have had a good example of it indeed on this key reflection from the Oslo conference. And it really reminded me some of the work that has been done in the in some other region, East Africa or WECARO, but also with the African Union. It's really to try to continue also to advocate with other bodies such as the regional entity, intergovernmental body, national actors, basically to really influence and make sure that they do include child protection consideration in their policies, their roadmap, their legislation. There have been some attempts, sometimes quite successful in East Africa, for instance. And that is really a way also to promote the centrality of protection, because at the end of the day, those who will have to implement those policy, legislation or commitment that have been done at the AU level or some other regional entity will have to be implemented. These are strong commitment and political commitment that will need to be operationalized. So maybe looking at all these entry points that also have a bit of, you know, beyond the community level advocacy that we can do or at the humanitarian leadership level, there's a lot of other entry points maybe at these other layers that can have a real impact as well in the ground. Mm-hmm. If that makes sense.
It does, absolutely. So taking that more strategic advocacy focus of now if we're saying we want the leadership to do this, well, let's take the different leaders in turn and see how they're doing, see what they've committed to, hold them to account. Yes, and obviously building on the AU role in the Oslo conference will be key. Okay, fantastic. And I see we've now fully assembled our panel. So I'd like to pass next to Stephen from the Nigeria Hub to see from his perspective where he's sitting, what he's seen this week, from his colleagues in the room, a couple of minutes of what do we need to do to get other humanitarian actors to incorporate the centrality of children and their protection into their work. So over to you, Stephen.
Thank you very much, Camilla, and thank you very much to everyone. It has been actually a very wonderful session of learning, on learning and relearning. And without wasting much of our time, considering the fact that we're working within a very short time frame, one thing I actually thought the humanitarian actors would do is to support research initiatives, right, that tends to understand the needs, the complexities, the vulnerability of children, right? And by so doing, you know, when we have these data, it helps in decision making, it helps in making informed decisions that put the needs and the centrality of children in the center of or in the peak of implementation and programming. Thank you, and over to you.
Okay, so better data at country level to be able to really push for this. And that definitely came out. UNHCR shared today their approach to prevention. And this was definitely one of the things that they're looking at, how the data is disaggregated, captured better within the humanitarian plans that are put out. So it's definitely something that different actors at different levels can look at, as well as then at community level too. Okay, so I'm going to hand to Brian. Brian, I believe, has been involved in the development of the graphic that we have in our centrality paper, or certainly members of the group that he's part of helped to design that graphic that we have in the background paper for this conference. So, Brian, over to you. What do you think that we need to do to get other humanitarian actors to incorporate the centrality of children and their protection into their work.
Hi, Camila, thank you so much. Yes, I was involved in the graphic and it was awesome. We, not just me, actually, a part of my group, actually, most of the people in my group called the hashtag COVID-19 initiative, an initiative under tidy homes. And yes, people loved it. It's interesting to give some feedback. I don't know if it was incorporated, but it was awesome and some awesome feedback was given. I think I was part of the session. I just want to say it was amazing. It was beautiful yesterday, right? And for the question that what do we need to get other humanitarian actors to incorporate the centrality of children on a meeting about Agenda 2040 that is for African. And I was just trying to see.
I think we might be struggling a little bit with Brian's connection. So we'll pause you there, Brian, and see if we can get you back in again in a little while. Okay, so for now, I think we'll move on to the second question and then we'll come back to Brian if we can later on. So what did you think was the key learning from the event for you personally and or for the child protection and humanitarian action sector? So I'd like to hear from Kana on this one, and then we'll go to Hussein.
Thanks so much, Camila. Yeah, it's hard to distinguish between the personal and the professional key learning, primarily because our endeavor is child protection cause driven, and that holds deep personal significance, but I'll try. So in terms of personal, our child protection past is our drive for the future. That's my key learning. The timeline session at the onset of the annual meeting served as a powerful testimony of this, that our past of fearlessness, thinking outside the box, and the ability to turn the impossible into possible serves as a driving force for us to persist in our collective pursuit of excellence. It was not a mere coincidence that the video and the a timeline document prepared by Learning and Development Working Group and the Secretariat reminded me of the significant role played by Eglantine and Dorothy Jebb. Their child target response and the declaration that later on informed the UNCRC emphasized that the leadership of women in these sectors is from its inception, from the get-go. And this serves as a powerful reminder to me that by embracing fairlessness, innovative thinking, and persisting in centrality of children, their protection, we collectively can indeed achieve remarkable outcomes for and with girls and boys. A century ago, it was possible, and today it is even more so.
Fantastic. Well, I'm sure there's women in the room who are, who are pleased to hear that. And yes, I also found that the reflection on those two wonderful women leaders at the forefront of our sector to be inspiring. Okay, and the same question to Hussein from the Iraq Hub. What did you think was the key learning from the event for you personally or for the child protection and humanitarian action sector? Or for the Hub?
Shukran jazilan tidaan in hadi al-fursa. I will talk in Arabic because for my colleague it's here talking Arabic. بالنتيجة التجربة حقيقة كانت كلش مهمة ومفيدة. من الأمور اللي جدا أثرت بينا هو قضية الأطفال اللي تم استضافتهم في داخل الجلسات اللي موجودة. قصة روبا والباقي الأطفال والمراهقين اللي تم استضافتهم. حقيقة هم تعرضوا إلى مخاطر كبيرة متعلقة بحماية الطفل، ولكن من حاضرين بقوة وتحدثوا بثقة عالية شلون تعاملوا ويا هذه المواقف، وأصبحوا هم مناصرين ومدافعين عن قضايا حماية الطفل. هذه واحدة من الأمور المهمة اللي إحنا يحتاج نركز عليها، ولربما بأعمالنا القادمة ممكن نركز بشكل تفصيلي أكثر على يعني هذه التجارب من ناحية الأطفال، لأنه التأثير راح يكون بشكل أكبر من قوم بحملات مناصرة أو حملات مدافعة، من يكونون الأطفال نفسهم أصحاب القضية هم جزء من هذه الحملات بالنتيجة هنا راح يكون التأثير أكبر على على المجتمع. فحقيقة كانت القصص جدا ملهمة وكانوا يتمتعون بالشجاعة العالية. أعتقد من المهم جدا بأنه إحنا نعمل مع بعض من خلال على نظام الحماية التشاركي من خلال التنسيق ما بين الحكومات والمجتمعات بالإضافة للمنظمات الدولية والمنظمات الوطنية والفاعلين الدوليين حتى نوفر الحماية ونكيف كل الأوضاع بحالات الطوارئ وخصوصا قضية التغيرات المناخية اللي موجودة حاليا في سبيل بأنه نوفر المظلة الآمنة والحماية للأطفال لأنه بنتيجة هم الأطفال مسؤولية الجميع. قضية توفير الحماية لهم وقضية توفير البيئة الآمنة والمصلحة الفضلاء لهم اللي هي دائما. كل الجلسات بالحقيقة هي كانت رائعة ومميزة، استفدنا كثير من التجارب اللي انطرحت عالميا. الزملاء اللي موجودين هنا بمركز المشاركة حقيقة هم يعني عبروا بشكل كلش كبير عن امتنانهم للحضور بهذا خلينا نقول الاجتماع، لأنه هذه التجارب العالمية هي مفيدة جدا بأنه يتم الاطلاع عليها، خصوصا أغلب السياقات هي خصوصا سياقات الصراع هي سياقات مشابهة للسياق العراقي، فهذه التجارب راح نستفاد منها بالإضافة إلى منق المعلومات والمعارف اللي تضمن كثير من الأدلة التدريبية والإرشادات والحزم الأدوات المتعلقة بقضايا مختلفة من ضمنها عمالة الأطفال، زواج الأطفال والقاصرات، الأطفال في نزاع مع القانون وارتباطهم بالجماعات المسلحة والتأثيرات المناخية وتغييرات المناخية وتأثيرها على الأطفال وقضايا الصحة النفسية والصحة العقلية. هذه كانت كلها من الأمور اللي استفدنا منها كثيرا، وشكرا جزيلا لكم وشكرا بأنه إحنا موجودين جزء من الاجتماع العالمي ضمن منصة العراق. Thank you كاملة.
Thank you, Hussein and colleagues, for those reflections. Yes, it is indeed inspiring to hear the children's perspectives, not just in the sessions, but also, you know, that call to action that we need to be working more hand in hand with children as part of communities. The principle of subsidiarity, where decisions are made closest to those who are affected by them, I think has really been a key takeaway from this meeting, that we need to be engaging those most affected in part of the decision making, in the analysis of the issues, in the planning of the responses, not just about giving feedback on what we do and we've decided to do. With that in mind, I'm wondering if we can return to Brian, see if his connection's a bit better, to respond to the first question. Maybe we can head back to this previous slide as well.
Can you guys hear me now? I actually didn't realize you couldn't hear me before. Can you hear me now?
It's better now, yeah. But feel free to turn your video off because it might help with your bandwidth.
I actually don't understand because I'm the only one who's using Wi-Fi.
It's just one of those things, isn't it, sometimes? But we can hear you very well now.
Awesome. That is awesome. Because I was actually telling you guys that I was in another meeting previously and there were a lot of good suggestions on the implementation, on how to influence children to implement Agenda 2040. But the main challenge that was there, and it actually just relates to what we can do to get other humanitarian actors to incorporate the centrality of children and their protection into their work, was that organizations, NGOs working with children, for children or to children, do not share data. They don't work together at all. Every organization prefers to just start their own thing, even though there are some other people who are doing the same thing, you know. And it's a major problem because there's a lot of resources that are wasted, resources that could have been utilized somewhere else. So I guess firstly, I would just love to start with that. Sharing data, working together as NGOs. You know, as children of Africa, here in Africa, I would first of all just say big up to them. I mean, we've worked together ourselves. We have fought for ourselves. We came from a place, the Day of the African Child is tomorrow, by the way, so feel free to join us. But we've worked together from a place where the Day of the African Child was celebrated in conference rooms with old people to now where we hold child-led events with children from the planning committee. So yes, I would invite you organizations as well to do the same thing, you know, to do what African children are doing, to just come together, share resources, share data. I think sharing data is actually more important. Share data, share resources so that we can work together. I mean, it's for the good of children after all, right? So yeah, let's work together. But I would also say that advocating for policies and guidelines that explicitly recognize the centrality of children and their protection in humanitarian work. We'll actually engage with relevant international organizations, government agencies, and non-governmental organizations to promote the adoption and implementation of child-centered policies. As I was writing this down, I bolded this word, explicitly recognize the centrality of children, you know. The centrality of children in especially humanitarian work is usually covered up in policies, wrapped up in so many words, which makes it very hard to, number one, account for it, number one, recognize it, and number two, account for it. So I think we need to advocate for policies that explicitly recognize the centrality of children and their protection in humanitarian work. This is what I was talking about yesterday, if you're in yesterday's meeting, about the accountability of children, to children that is. I actually mentioned step by step, right? Step by step, decision by decision, response by response system. Working together, decision by decision, just making sure that whenever these children are there, number one, they know what you're doing, and number two, they're helping you do it, okay? And speaking of which, just to focus on the topic of working together and knowing what they're doing, I'd also love to just mention the providing training and capacity building, you know, especially to children, offering training programs and capacity building initiatives to humanitarian actors to enhance, not for anything else, but to enhance the understanding of child protection issues, and to keep them with the necessary skills and knowledge to integrate child-centered approaches into their work. I don't want to talk too much because I understand that sometimes we get lost in the so many words and all, but I think that those things are the most important things as for now, you know?
Lovely.
I think that's
lovely.
Why?
No, that's great. I heard you really speaking to Elsa's point of, you know, you're saying get it into the policies. She's saying hold them to account when they've put it in the policies. You're also highlighting the data piece, the collaboration piece, the capacity strengthening piece. So, yeah, it's really wonderful to hear those reflections from you, Brian. Thank you very much. I'm so glad we got to hear your voice in the end, despite the connection issue earlier. Okay, well, we just had like one last question, and we really only have about one more minute for this segment. So I just wanted to see if any of the panelists wanted to share any final reflections on what the CPHA sector should be doing better. So feel free to jump in. I think Kana Hussein and Elsa had all prepared a little on this response. Kana, please go ahead.
Sure, absolutely. One key learning for me and for the sector actually is the management and leadership. There is no discussion that CPHA is life-saving in its nature, and it enables positive outcome for children's well-being. However, we should be reminded that CPHA is not merely a program or advocacy, it's also a mission to exert influence. During this event, Cornelius emphasized the need to influence agency management, which is applicable, I know, for so many agencies and as well as certain donors. It's important to accept that CPHA is complex. Therefore, we must embrace that complexity while tailoring our narrative to specific audience, management in this case, aiming to influence increased commitment towards prioritizing CPHA, enhancing capacities and allocated resources. It's truly remarkable and impactful when one of the children who participated in the session articulated that if leaders fail to prioritize child protection, it means that they have never met us. And this statement serves as an indicator of how our narrative looks like to the management and the donors for those that have not yet embraced the centrality of children and where our focus could be. And quickly, I would like to say that there was also a very specific suggestion from non-CPHA colleague from the emergency unit suggesting whether we could use best interest of the child principle while influencing that these principles could underpin any response as a paramount for the centrality of children and their protection. And the very last thing I want to say is that the evidence of change for our sectors, it needs to move a bit onto the evidence of the drivers of sustainability. So we have to move from prioritizing access as a reason to be locally driven towards fostering ownership. And that would be great if we could actually capture that in the evidence, the authentic solution from the community, local actors, including girls and boys, including faith leaders and faith actors, and challenging our bias regarding to that. And as the youngest girl, the youngest child, sorry, in the annual meeting mentioned, she's Miradia, 10 years old, from DRC. She said in the second day, in a simple and powerful way, if I'm afraid, I cannot change the situation. But if I'm not afraid, I can speak for those who are so vulnerable that they cannot speak for themselves. And we should not be afraid to make those changes. Thanks.
One of the women leaders that you earlier mentioned, upcoming. Okay, lovely. Thank you very much, Elsa. Kaina, over to Elsa, and then we'll come back to Hussein to wrap up. And Stephen, I think I missed you on the last question. Please do forgive me. We're a little over time. Elsa, did you have any final remarks on this last question? I think the slides come down, but what should the CPHA sector be doing better?
There's not much time, so there was already a lot that has been said, and really I love the speech of Brian. I love the cartoons, so I guess that's not about CP Alliance, something that you should do better, but actually to continue to do. Maybe just one thing that I really like in one of the sessions, and I don't know who's that coming from, but there's someone in the audience that basically say that to accept to change my plan, because to accept that my plan or my program will change because of the input of the child. And I think that to me, that was really, I think that can resume a bit the whole discussion about centrality of child protection in the change that we need to continue. I mean, for the Alliance, I guess, and the entire community to continue to explore the ways to engage with the local actors, but also to be ready to change the narrative based on the input of the kids. Sometime we are getting there somehow, but probably something that we can continue to do even better. And I think that there have been some discussion that really were quite striking and inspiring when it comes to how do we engage better with the children, with the community, with the local actors? How do we give them space? And I think that the drawer was saying, actually in one of the drawings, there is this sentence about saying we you work for us. I mean, you don't work for the local organization. So anyway, sorry. That's why really something that I liked in the whole session. Thank you.
Wonderful. And yes, we need to bring these other actors into the sessions where we've got these powerful child speakers, I think, to let them hear it for themselves, as Kaina was quoting. Okay, any final remarks from Hussein before we wrap up this session?
نعم باختصار شديد أنا أتفق مع إلسا بشأن إيصال صوت الأطفال دائما بأنه نستمع لهم وهم يكونون في قمة الهرم بالإضافة إلى أنه من المهم جدا بأنه إحنا نعمل مع الفاعلين الدوليين بشكل مباشر للضغط على الحكومات في سبيل إبعاد الأطفال عن مناطق النزاع ومناطق الصراع إبعادهم عن الحروب لأنه بالنتيجة الأطفال ما لازم يتأثرون بخلافاتنا السياسية ومشاكلنا إحنا ككبار بالأساس والنتيجة راح نأثر على حياة هذول الأطفال هذا على المستوى العالمي لربما على المستوى الوطني في كثير من البلدان اللي تفتقر لحد الآن إلى القوانين الوطنية اللي تهتم بالأطفال وتوفر الحماية والمظلة لهم اللي من ضمنها العراق حالياً نتمنى بأنه أيضا نستمر إحنا كمنظمات وكفاعلين لمجال حماية الطفل بالضغط على الحكومات في سبيل تشريع القوانين اللي توفر الحماية وأيضا نضغط من خلال خلينا نقول المستوى الوطني وأيضا المستوى الإقليمي والعالمي على الحكومات بشأن تطبيق أو خلينا نقول تفعيل التزامات الحكومات تجاه الاتفاقيات والمعاهدات الدولية اللي موقع عليها بشأن توفير الحماية للأطفال، بالإضافة إلى البرامج بالتأكيد اللي إحنا مستمرين بها بقضية توفير الخدمات والحماية والوقاية والاستجابة لحالات الطوارئ فيما يتعلق بالأطفال. ختاما شكرا جزيلا لكم، وتحية من العراق ومن كل المنظمات المشاركة واللي موجودة معانا هنا، ونتمنى بأنه نلتقي الكثير من عندكم، نستضيفكم أيضا بالعراق، لربما هسه بعض الزملاء احنا ملتقين بهم وشايفينهم من المشاركين بالمؤتمر بكثير من الأحداث داخل العراق، ونتمنى بأنه نكون احنا مع بعض بهدف واحد لإيصال صوت الأطفال وتوفير الحماية لهم. شكرا جزيلا.
Thank you very much, Hussein, for those final reflections. And thank you to everyone on the panel, Hussein, Stephen, Brian, Elsa and Kana. We'll hand now to Hani for some final remarks and thanks before closing out. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. And if we can have the slide up, please. Yes, just quickly to thank those that have been heavily involved in making this a reality. I'll actually start by mentioning the children themselves who have been involved in this. We had Mariam Oseni in the Nigeria Participation Hub. We had Ruba, Akorede, Jeshis, Brian, Mariana. Brian, borderline child, he's just become an adult. Mariana, Jason, Miradi, Dola, Bodana and Victoria, who have been with us throughout this week. In terms of our kind of steering committee, others who contributed, our steering committee members who actually made this possible, UNICEF, World Vision, IRC, Child Fund, War Child UK, and Terrorism have been instrumental in making this happen, partially financially. The Bureau of Population and Migration of the United States that has provided the most significant part of the funds for this. We had a task team comprised of CPAR, Joyce from CPAR, Elena from the Learning and Development Working Group, Minya from Save the Children, and Kristen Hope from Terre des Hommes, who helped us shape the planning phase of this event. We had quite a number of individuals who helped us do the review of the abstracts. For sake of time, I'm not going to read everyone's name, but the names are up there. All our producers, Julie, Natalie, Stacy, Osman, Lisa, Seleke, and Sam. Interpreters, thank you very much for the work that you did. And artists that helped us do the drawing, Alex and Royston. Those will remain with us, so we'll always remember you guys. And huge thanks goes to the secretariat team who have been working for this for about 6 months. It's kind of hard to even accept that it's ending because we have been working on it for so long that it feels like it can't end yet. But it is, and we will see you guys all next year. I just wanted to say that I know you have all done a lot of mentees and polls and everything, but please take the time to give us one final feedback on the entirety of the week. So colleagues will post the poll in the chat. We will also later share it with you through email. So if you haven't gotten a chance today, I really hope that you do it now while your mind is fresh, but you can also do it in the next few weeks. So. With that, we would like to ask colleagues to producers, especially Julie, who has been the lead producer, to help us celebrate the closing of the session with some music. And I invite everyone to turn on their camera and dance it out.